man. Michael was banging. The original baby father was Michael. There's two baby fathers, I say originals. Darth Vader and Michael Jackson.
You are the father.
Darth Vader, how did he come into
I said they're two baby fathers, isn't it? Because you know that.
Have you not seen Star Wars? You know?
Original baby fathers.
Yeah. And Michael Jackson is saying, the kid ain't mine.
What man? This one you just know. Michael Jackson said what he wants. He said, the kid ain't mine.
Yeah. I loved it. He said, Billie Jean is not my lover. She's just a girl. Who claims that I am the one. But the kid is not my son.
You know what? Lyrics. One day I listened to that tune, yeah, and I thought, you know what, Michael's deep in that.
He's deep. A bad man. He's a pop-up band. He did not have it. He didn't ask for paternity or nothing. He said, that ain't mine, fam.
When he put it in song and it went top 10, number one, that he knows.
Ain't mine.
Yo, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, cats and dogs, rodents and other small insects. This is episode number 3 of Eloquently Saying Nothing. This is Stavros Boss speaking. I hope you're all doing well. Let's see who else we have in the room.
Well, hello's in the building, people. As always, what's good? I hope everybody's had a good and fantastic productive week. And we're ready for another show.
303 is up her skirt. You will see me, the Black Parker, in the place to be.
This is Mr. Wolf in the place. That was quite funny, I won't lie. This is Mr. Wolf in the place, wondering whether cats, rodents and other insects actually listen to the show.
Of course they do.
Yeah, at somebody's house, there's probably a rat listening to you.
Not even a mouse, you know. A rat.
A rat listening out there. Well,
rat-infested house.
Yo, Simple Simon's in the building. I have no catchy, quirky tagline to drop at the beginning of this podcast. And it irks me so, because I find it quintessentially essential that I have a tagline. I'm normally quick with it. I don't have one right now.
Can I ask a question?
Your quick is gone.
Going on by what you just said. Whip it. Right, so we've established, yeah, in the world of the world, that pussy cat is what cats are called, yeah?
You said that in separate entities, you so
yeah, but I'm saying it. So, you know, you call it pussycat, innit? Right? So, pussycat, yeah, all that rubbish that you call a cat.
You do that again?
No. But let's. Okay, so let's say that you've been calling your cat pussycat for, I don't know, 3-4 years or so, yeah?
Hang on 1 minute. Do people legitimately call their cat pussycat?
I don't know, but this is what I'm getting to. Let's just say that we do, yeah?
Tom Jones does.
And then man's and their women's is having the times, isn't it, of their lives inside their bedrooms.
You're talking about like doing sex.
Sex. And the woman's saying stuff like, you know, treat the pussy, eat the pussy, everything the pussy. Do you think the cat sometimes gets confused?
Where the hell did that come from?
Ah, my pussy, my pussy. And then the cat does there's looks around the door. That's you.
Not you, pussycat.
Whoa. I'm just saying it because you never know, innit? You never know. And the dog's in the house, you call dog all the time. You don't know, blacks don't even give dog names, they just call it dog. Yeah? And then one time she screamed, dog is now, dog is now. And the dog was coming out. Coming around one time. I mean, I can't.
Blacks call their
dog. Hang on 1 second, Wahala. What dog got a bad to ask?
Because it's dog. I didn't say dog, bruv. I said dog.
Blacks call their dog Tyson, whites call their dog Rover.
Wow.
There ain't no black man that call their dog Rover.
Oh my gosh. Where did you come with all this? What do they call that, prejudice and what's the other thing?
I don't know.
Stereotypes.
Yeah, I don't know.
Oh no.
I don't know self.
Man said.
Oh, can you imagine? How do cats and dogs, your pets feel when you is there? Especially some of these people that let their animals sleep in the same room as them. What, do they shoot them out? Or what? Come out tonight, me and the wife gonna have some fun. Get out.
Do you actually think cats know that they're called pussycats?
I'm just saying in general now, like, you're making all this hype of noise in the bedroom, doing all this palaver, and the cat is just there trying to sleep. Like,
nobody here has an animal, right? Nobody has got a pet, basically. So, but what I would like to know is, for those out there in podcast land, is that when you are entering your woman or the girls are doing their guy, do you allow the animal to mingle around the room or the bedroom?
Can you imagine the cat just tap you on your shoulder or something?
I'll be honest with you. Yeah, simple, Simon. I got a story,
you have,
yeah?
You have, I know you have.
I've got a story about this exact same subject, yeah? A long, long time ago, long, long time ago, before I was born again, obviously, I'm doing the sex. I'm trying to. And no word of a lie, I must have looked over my shoulder and the cat's just there looking at me in the face. Yeah, like this. And I'm like, this ain't really happening, innit? This cat's not really looking at me. So I kind of like moved a little bit. Cat just stayed there. So I whispered in the girl's ear, why is the cat looking at me? I was like, oh, don't worry about it. She must have like moved to shoo the cat. Cat jumps off the bed.
The cat was on the bed.
Yeah, the cat came to go on the
with
bed.
You.
Not like on in, but like, you know, like standing on the back two legs. It was probably, that's what I'm saying, it was watching. The cat was watching.
Picking up moves and ideas.
I don't know what the cat was watching.
Was it masturbating? Was it being pat the pussy? Oh, yes. Oh, yeah. Oh yeah, give it to me. Look at my fur.
I'm gonna lick myself right now.
No, come on.
Yeah, well, pussy lick licking the pussy. They all lick themselves already.
Pussy
licking
the pussy. Oh, they do.
Maybe that's their masturbation. They lick themselves.
Oh my gosh. But anyway, so she shooed the cat away. The cat went away.
Came back.
No, get back and. But the cat came back. The cat came back. That's the point. And then I felt something tapping me on the leg. And why is it tapping me on the leg? I swear to you.
Yeah, bro, move over.
No word of a lie. No word of a lie or exaggeration. The cat was tapping me on the leg. And I'm there like, this cat really just tapped me on the leg.
Simple. I'm kicking that cat like the baby in 2016. I'm kicking it clean out of the room. It's good. I'm waiting for the cat touching you. I'm a big guy, I'm quite large, and I don't give a damn. I'll tell you, I'm scared of them beasts there. I'm not involved.
You know, but the thing about cats is they're quite autonomous, right?
They're beasts.
No, man, they're like, they got their own identity as far as like animals are concerned. It's like cats and elephants that just don't give a damn about your life. They just care about themselves and stuff.
I'm sorry, I'm not, we went completely off topic. I just wanted to.
We didn't even get the topic, that's how bad it is.
Well, it's his fault. Well, when I say his fault, I mean. Mr. Wolf's fault, because he mentioned the cats and dogs and the rodents.
It's true.
Yes, it is true.
And actually, then I just thought of the pussy, and then I thought, yes. Don't ask me why.
And then I just thought, but you do that. Ask, you do pose a really interesting question, whether cats, I'm not even cats, it's just animals in general. You know, like humans will watch animal mating and they'll take photos of it or whatever, or they'll have like a YouTube video and people watch it and go, ah.
You think animals have YouTube videos watching humans?
Not necessarily, but like, would an animal turn up the opportunity to watch a human doing it, or would they stay there and watch? That's the question.
They will watch.
I think that when dogs see people having sex doggy style, they rate themselves for it. Innit? So that's my style.
I did.
That's my style. They got that from me, fam. You see that? Look, watch his leg out mounts that. That's me, fam.
Hey, Tyson, check out this move right here.
That's me, fam. I showed that's him a bad that. Man move. I showed it. I've been doing that some 07, bro.
Oh, mate.
Okay.
Sorry, Stav Ricky.
No. There's no sorry, man. It's all good. It's all
pretty
good.
Pretty Ricky.
Not
pretty at all, bro.
Why you have to do that?
It's the truth. Damn. It's all good. Okay, so question was asked. Best day of your life. Very simple, very easy. Does anyone have an answer? Because we did discuss it just before we started recording, and I don't think anyone can think off the top of their head what the best day of their lives was.
It's a terrible question, especially for the parents among us, because the cliche thing to say is your child, the birth of your child was the best day of your life. Is the cliche thing to say?
But I don't see how seeing your woman's vagina open that way. And then, okay, listen, let me say how many reasons why it shouldn't be the best. Your woman's vagina opens up wider than you should ever think it should open up in life, yeah? If your man's a doctor, next man's touching your woman's pom-pom, that's sacrilege, a normal day, every other day. So why is it that this day is all good that if they're touching it and caressing the thing?
What's wrong with you?
No, but it's true, like, the poop nanny. Why is they touching it more than you've touched it in your life? You've touched it in areas that you haven't touched it yourself. Acting like it's not real.
Let's he's trying to get the hold head on. Out.
Wait, have you ever put your hand, your whole hand inside?
Thankfully, in fact, not.
I don't even ask that question. I don't even want
to
know.
Even to add to that, when it actually tears as well.
Now, why do you have to go there for?
I'm just saying.
And then I hear that some women shits as
and
well.
Some women shit. Yeah.
No, this can't be a good time for everybody that's watching it from the other side. Yeah.
Simple Simon is 100% right. That is the cliche. And some people will go as far as to say that, and I am one of them. But we're not talking about the process. So,
Mr. Wolf, you're saying the birth of your child.
Wait, which child
was the best one? Day of your life?
I've got to be honest, innit? I mean, even when my daughter gets older, the first is more special for me, in my opinion. It's not.
No, do you know what?
Simple Simon,
I'm going to back him. You know why I'm going to back him?
It's not her fault.
For one reason, yes. And for one reason and one reason only, yeah? Your first anything has no, there's no precedence. You've never had any experience before. So you don't know how to be. You don't know how to be.
Nah. So what are you trying to say that your first is
you don't know what to expect, right? You don't know what to expect. You don't know how to be. So whether you like it or not, let's just say that the first experience may not be necessarily the best, but it's going to be the most special.
No, I think so. I don't guess so. Because Black Parker, because you will always say that was better than the first time. And if it was better than the first time, does that make it more special?
Yeah, but after you've done it the first time, what is it better than?
But what you have to remember.
How can you say the first time was better or special, because the next time will be always
it's always
going to
be special because it's the first time, isn't it? Yeah. Even if it's not good, it's the first time.
Nah,
but that doesn't make it special.
All right,
it just makes it the first time.
Yeah. Let's be honest. Yeah, are we saying the first time in certain instances? Because there's certain things you can do the first time, and then there's certain things you can do the first time while doing the thing you did the first time.
What
again?
And what time would that be?
Okay, let's because I don't want to be filth, but let's say that you have
be
sex
filth,
with
filth
man. Yeah?
Man.
Right? And I don't know, the first time you have sex, you just stick it in 2 times and pull out and bounce. Yeah, that's you. That's
that what happened.
Right? That was it.
Yo, Paul.
Is that what happened?
No, that's not happening with me, but let's just say it happened. Yeah,
yo, Paul. Right? Yeah, why?
So that's
why your peel?
Oh, it's all special. And let's say that the fifth time now, yeah,
you only pump once.
No, I'm saying the fifth time, yeah. It's all 20-minute head, you know what I mean? Like the good, lavish head where they bring the lotions.
go on.
I know that stuff. You know, everything is all taken care of for you. You have the best time of your life. You don't know, you have 5 hours worth of tantric sex, if you can handle that. And then you think to yourself, that's a good sex, right? But the first sex you had was meant to be more special. But this one has had extra things that's not been happening in the first sex.
But what
so
you
it's
have
kind
to,
of new to you.
What you have
you
to
know
remember,
I mean.
Wahala, is that it's subjective, innit? So everybody's different. Everyone's going to have their different feeling. You understand? So where, for me, the first time, I'm not talking about sex, the first born, Mr. Wolf has got two children.
I think you mean objective, by the way.
Oh, sorry. I'll get it mixed up. Objective. Mr. Wolf has got two kids, a boy and a girl. My son came first. And for me, it's one of the best moments of my life.
But what's the best then?
I'm not sure. I don't know if I can. I don't know.
You're the one that came with his dad.
Definitely a football moment.
You just start.
Wow.
Without a doubt.
Okay, you know what? Yeah.
Hard on business.
One of my favourite moments
definitely
ever.
Definitely a football moment.
Which makes no sense at all. Makes no sense at all. Is with MGF. Right? This is Web Slinger's older brother. Let's salute because we know he's passed.
Salute.
And we watched the final where
Champions League.
Yeah, Champions League final. And
one
I don't
of my
like,
best
Wahala hates Liverpool with a passion. I'm an Arsenal man and I hate Liverpool. I hate Liverpool even more than I probably hate Tottenham because of the supporters and the scum that they are. Right? But
hang on, wait. I don't know how to put this into perspective. Do you hate Liverpool more or less than you hate Ghanaian Jollof?
They're on par.
Yee, that's
they're
a
on
lot.
Par. Because Ghanaian Jollof is you know, it's edible. To dogs and cats.
Wow. Dogs and cats are looking at you right now saying, bastard.
There was a one time, I'm going off topic, but I'm not lying to you. I want you to understand, Wahala is not lying to you. There was one time I saw on the streets, yeah, somebody had threw away some, it was basmati Ghanaian jollof, right? So you know it was no the difference. You know when you can see the difference, you can tell when you look at them, yes? You can do that, yeah? It would be thrown on the floor, yeah? And a pigeon went up to the jollof, yeah? Looked at it. I don't walk away. I'm not lying. The pigeon walked up to the jollof rice. I walked away. I'm telling you. If the pigeon and me could talk, it almost like it saluted me like, yeah, bro, I understand that. That's not my life. I walked away from the jollof rice. Pigeon that would take common bread. Walked away from the basmat.
I'm finished.
Walked away I'm from finished. It.
No, bro.
Looked at it. And I walked away.
The podcast is over. Oh,
my God. I can't remember what I was saying now. Yeah, so sorry. Was it 2004?
Yeah,
the Champions League. Was it 2004 Champions League game?
Yeah.
And yeah, was that MGF's house? And Liverpool obviously came back and won that game. And the passion in that time when that happened in that house would be one of the most memorable moments I ever had.
Stavros was there as well. Shay was there. Big up Shay. Big up yourself. Long time no see.
Shay, what? Justice.
Yeah, Justice. Yeah,
from
Boulevard.
Boy group back in the day. Oh, and they both Liverpool supporters. They were there watching it. Me and my brother, both Arsenal supporters, hate Liverpool supporters. And they were losing 3-0 at half time, innit? Or something like that.
Yes.
And then they came back and won in the second half. And them two jumped up, hugged each other, and were jumping. I recorded that, you know, and I've lost that recording. Okay. And that. It was a good moment. It was a good moment.
The best moment of my life.
Stavros almost looked like he was about to cry.
No, I'm crying because of the jollof thing from before. I actually have tears in my eyes.
I want you to understand, I'm not joking about that. The pigeon walked up to the jollof and walked away.
That's deep, man. But Mr. Wolf is a big football man. I coach young kids. And I'm a Liverpool fan. And that, without doubt, was one of my favourite moments in life. Say what you like. Call me shallow, but yeah, I'm a football man, and that was very enjoyable.
Is it a moment or a whole day?
Huh?
Is that a moment or a whole day?
It's a moment.
It's a day.
What was your favorite day, or was it moment?
Well, it's a day. It can be part. Well,
part of a day.
Yeah.
Part of a day.
Because I tell you what, the process of my first son being born, even my daughter was not good at all. You know.
So the relief at the end was more than anything else.
Relief and joy.
Okay, so you're saying a football game and your child, but only one of them.
I'll probably think of something else when I'm battering my toast in the morning, but those two for now.
Stavros would chime in and say, I have a child, and I don't know what the best day of my life is, but I'm not automatically chalking that one up to it. And
You're a G anyway, straight up G.
Thank you.
Why are you calling him a G for no reason?
Because Stavros, the boss, Winchos, was responsible for the birth of his daughter.
The way you made that sound like...
Because it's an epic story, you know what I mean? Of all proportions. It's the kind of thing that you only hear about in the movies.
I don't think it's
Stavros was the midwife. That's it.
That's the thing we've got to say, because when you said responsible for his child, I'm assuming that more people...
Yeah.
What do we mean that to be the case?
The birth, yeah, but not the conception. The birth.
Well, for the listeners out there, my wife and I, obviously she was pregnant, and at some point at night, this was after the opening of my brother's wife's shop, actually, and we got home.
That's right.
And she said, you know, I'm feeling some pains that I haven't felt before. I said, do you think it's contraction? She's like, I'm not too sure. We had an appointment in the morning anyway, so I said, let's see what happens. Me being a black bastard, I fell asleep and left her with her contractions herself. And basically, she woke me up and she said, you know, I'm feeling pain. I think these are contractions. I said, all right, cool. What do you want to do? And blah, blah, blah. Anyway, long story short, we had an appointment with the hospital, with the midwife in the morning. Anyways, we went there. They said, yes, you're having contractions. Yes, you're dilated. Go home. Come back when such and such and such. So, okay, we went home. And then basically...
I fell asleep again.
I
text my family and said, you know,
twice.
Yeah. Just left there.
Yeah, man. I'm married now. I don't need to try hard anymore.
Anyway, wow.
I text my family and said, you know what? Yeah, she'll soon be in labor. We're trying to get some sleep though. Laters. Don't bother us. And then it's only later on everyone said, who do you think can sleep through labor, Stavros? clearly you're a man. Yeah. So anyways, basically, she woke me up a couple of hours later. Like, I've been screaming at you.
Did you go to sleep a third time?
No. Only twice. Basically, she woke me up. She said, you know, this is too much. We have to go. I said, yeah, cool, no problem. Let's go. We had everything packed and ready. She said, you know, I'm not going to make it. I said, well, are you going to make it or not? She's like, I don't know. And it was like she was waiting for me to make the decision. And I said, listen, I don't mind being alpha male. I don't mind making decisions for you. But this is one of the times where you have to tell me, are we going to go to the hospital or are we going to stay here? You know, me being a legend that I am, because I am a legend, I got no problem staying here and doing the thing myself. And then she thought about it. She said, we're not going to make it to the hospital. We're going to have to stay here. No problems. Called up 999. They said, do X, Y, and Z. You know, there's a couple of things I told them I ain't doing because we had some lessons and stuff before. But basically, I just delivered the baby at home.
You didn't need to phone 999. You should have just gone on YouTube. They would have just
just told you how to do it on YouTube.
I don't know if we had time.
Or ask Alexa, innit? Alexa!
How do you give birth
with the baby?
So fortunately, everything went well. Fortunately, it's only later on you start realising, you know, there's 100 things that could have gone wrong. But fortunately, everything went well. Baby came out and...
Did she say it the same when she came out?
Oh, please. don't start this nonsense with me. Anyway, so, yeah, and that was that. The ambulance came a few minutes later, but fortunately for me and my wife, we had just the three of us were there, and we had a few minutes just as a family unit. I said it was a girl. She said, but I see something. I said, babe, that's the umbilical cord.
So you were the first person to hold your child?
I was the first person to hold the child. She came out in the sack. She had a head full of hair. I could see everything, man.
You cut the sack?
No, the sack burst. She was still in the sack as she was coming out, and then it burst as she came out. So, yeah, I did the
it's
thing.
It's too
know,
much
the
for
thing.
Me, man. All right, so when you held the baby, because they say you're supposed to give the baby straight to the mum, innit?
Skin to skin.
Yeah.
So you did that, yeah?
Yeah.
Because I can see you being a selfish bastard and rubbing it against you first. I am the father. Go.
Yeah, now go to your mother.
Go to your mother. Let us know which one is first.
So even with that story, I'm still not saying that necessarily the best day of my life.
Is that story-wise then, is that the best story of your life?
It depends. That's gotta be up there. I don't know, because for me, it's not the biggest deal. Probably because my ego is so big, I just don't see
I deliver babies all the time.
But
but there are people that do that all the time.
Yeah, it's true. Exactly. Delivering a baby is as much as I think it's a special story for me, my wife, and my child. But for somebody that's an outsider listening to it, a lot of men are saying, I couldn't have done it. And I'm thinking, well, you could have done it, because what else are you going to do? And they're like, I'd have gone to the neighbour and gotten it. I'd have gone to find the nearest woman. I would have called my mom.
There is bare uncles that would never have even... They would have drunk themselves silly.
Have you noticed? Everything I'm saying is in the uncle voice, because it was all uncles. I wouldn't do it. I couldn't do it.
You've got to remember that a lot of people do. This is Mr. Wolf. You've got to remember that a lot of people do get turned off by the sight of their woman's vagina in that situation, and also they don't just get turned off, they faint.
Yeah.
You understand? So as much as you may be or egotistical or whatever,
look at the pussy.
I don't faint at the sight of the tick, I get joy from
the
sight of the tick.
You don't know
joy
thing.
It's definitely a big deal.
Yeah, it's a big deal for me,
but it's not one of the moments that you would consider the best.
So the
three of you are saying.
Yeah, the three of us here that actually have children.
It's getting bigger.
Go away.
None of us are actually saying that. Mr. Wolf is saying that the birth of his children right up there as the best days of his life, along with a football game. And Simple Simon and Miss and Stavros are not necessarily co-signing that. I said Mr. Stavros because I was going to say Mr. Wolf.
No, oh, okay.
Just forgive me, please.
Yeah, I feel bad for it though. Like, I feel like it should be the best day.
And so you should.
This is why we wanted to, because we spoke about this a week ago or 2 weeks ago, but I didn't get around to talking about it on the podcast. And I really thought, because straight away I was going to say, oh, the birth of, it's not.
For me, I don't think the birth of the child is as special as when the child says daddy for the first time. I haven't got a child, but I can see the child coming to address me as daddy being more heartfelt for me and more of a thing for me than the child coming out the womb.
Well, on that note, can I just say, just to defend myself, if people think, you know, this guy is not a nice guy because he doesn't think the birth of his child is the best day of his life, I'm telling you, when I saw my wife and my daughter sleeping side by side, for me, I've told my wife, that was a better moment than the actual birth. Just
on the first day.
On the first day. Even now, if when I go home now from where we're recording and I see them sleeping together and I just open the door and there's one sleeping there and the other one sleeping there, I just love it.
Is that because you can sleep yourself now?
Yes. Yes. No noise. Yes. Just sleep, please.
So. Now, it's interesting you said that, Simple Simon. It's interesting you said that about the daddy thing, because that was nice. But the thing about children's development, like, you don't notice when it happens. Like, there's a point where you're saying, okay, they should be walking soon. And then all of a sudden they're running around the house. And you're like, when did that happen? Like, then you have to, like, look back at videos and stuff to see them and then say, oh, yeah, I do remember how that was. So for me, yes, daddy was... The first time she said daddy, not so much. What it is for me is... the fact that she still gets excited when she sees me. Like, I don't understand it. Like, I was even thinking about this every day. I was like, this child, every time I walk into the house after work, she's excited to see me. And her excitement is so genuine. Like, it's exactly the same as it was the very first time. And it just continues and remains the same. And I'm thinking to myself, why do you like me? Like, do you know what I mean?
This is the difference between me and you. The first thing I'm saying is, what has your mum done to you all day? It's like, when I come home, you're running to me. What have you been doing to her?
I get that same thing with my daughter, and she's still really young, but I come home from work and she looks at me, and then this big smile on her face.
Yeah, and it's like,
I'm telling you, man, anything wrong that day is just, it's washed away.
But come on, let's be real, innit? You lot have got girls as well. And I always say this, some people are like, daughters and their dads, that is the Superman. They love their dads to death. Mm-hmm. Like, to death. I always say children love their dads when they're young. That's the one they love the most. Maybe because they don't see them as much. Maybe because they're not the one that's telling them off. I don't know. But they always love their dads the most, especially the girls.
And that's what confuses me, though. That's what you touched on there about not seeing me that much. Because I go to work in the morning and I work, like, quite late in the evening. So sometimes I get back and she's not even still awake, and I won't see her again till the morning, kind of thing. But it's just like the consistency with, I don't know, it's like it's real raw emotion. Every single time I walk through the front door, it's like a party.
You're their father, innit?
I think it's got something to do with the fact that we do spend a bit less time with them than the mothers, because usually the men are choking up here. No, the men continue to work and the women are staying at home with the child, rearing the child 24/7. And it's just like, it's nice to see the dad.
The reason why I'm saying something's going on, yeah, because obviously, I would say obviously, but you lot don't know. I take my daughter to the nursery in the mornings. When there was a point where I was taking her, and obviously she was new and what have you. And then all of a sudden, I take her and I'm leaving, and all the other kids in the classroom are like, yeah, bye, daddy.
Yeah, I've heard that
before. To you.
To me.
Yeah. When they all call me daddy, is deep.
Have you heard that as well?
I've heard that, yeah.
So I'm convinced
But Mr. Wolf, you're not half Jamaican.
I'm gonna take you out of time. Lucifer, see, this thing, when you say stuff like Nigerians do not populate the whole world in most places.
Wow. Guy, just look at it. He said it and he danced as well. Anyway, so yeah, all the other children in the classroom all are like, yeah, bye daddy, bye daddy. I'm convinced that my daughter's told them something.
What?
I don't know.
That's my dad.
I don't know what she's told them.
He could be your daddy too.
The nursery's like quite multicultural and stuff, yeah?
Be careful, bro.
I got Japanese children saying. Yeah,
then they start asking for the support. Russian. The child support. And they take them to court and they ask, who's your daddy? That's my daddy.
hold on, simple. You have frequented Russia many times, haven't you?
No, come on, Nabeev.
This is that amazing child.
Do you have a stamp in your passport that is from Russia?
Eh?
With love.
This segues very nicely onto a topic that was sent to us from a young lady. And it's about... All right. There's stuff going on in Sweden now where people are trying to put up a petition or a request or whatever, trying to push it through, where they want a man to be able to
beat the child.
No. It's almost, it's like they call it, or it's been labeled like a male abortion.
Eh?
What happens is when you impregnate a woman, if by the 14th week you've decided I don't want anything to do with that child, you can sign a waiver basically and say, have nothing to do with that child. So I don't have to pay any kind of child support or anything like that. But also I have no rights to see the child. I have no rights. It's like I'm a stranger to that child. Like the child means nothing to me anymore, even for good and for bad. And they're trying to push that through at the moment in Sweden. What are your views on this?
That sounds very, very, very reminiscent to the stab term kicking him down the stairs.
Why? In what capacity?
Because I think that's a bit different.
Is it? All right, cool.
Yes.
My views on that. I actually don't know what my views on that is. That's kind of harsh.
But for me, that just rings of patriarchy, doesn't it?
In what capacity, though? Because
you have effectively... This is like a monopoly board. You just give a man a get out of jail card.
Yeah.
But what they're saying is that the woman... Okay, let's reverse it. The woman gets pregnant. You want the child. The woman says, no, I'm all right, thanks. I'm going to go get myself an abortion. You don't really have any rights to tell her no. So he's saying, like, both of you decided, you know, this child wasn't something that you wanted. If the woman decides she wants to keep the child, you don't really have any way of getting away from that. You just have to just deal with the situation and be like, well, okay. You could try and run off, but obviously they can. The law itself should find you and start finding you money or whatever. You don't necessarily have to see the child, but you should be paying for the child by law. Yeah, we all agree on that, right? But if the woman decides she wants to have an abortion within whatever time frame that the law says she's allowed to do that, you can't really stop her from doing that. So she does that, and then what do you do? So that's basically what it is. It's meant to be like a male version of saying, well, you know what? I know we had this sex. It was fantastic. I bust quick inside you. I didn't mean it. We're having a baby now. I don't really want this baby. You want this baby. You keep this baby. I'm going about my business.
Now, for me, I think generally we need to be like a little bit more responsible for our actions. If you're going to be doing sex with a woman and you're a man, like whether we like it or not, there's a possibility that someone's going to get pregnant.
Exactly.
So for me, you got to take kind of like responsibility for that. So you for going and go sign some paper saying, oh yeah, I don't have to assume any responsibility. I don't have to be financially responsible in any way, shape or form. As a matter of fact, I've just written this child off. I don't know.
But in some ways, what's happening is that the man, as Wahal mentioned earlier on, has no say. At present time, in modern society, well, in Western cultures, some other cultures where a man will have a say, but a man has no say in what's happening. So if the woman wants it, she has it, and then you're responsible for it as well. And if the woman doesn't want it, even if you do want it, you have no say in it. It's my body, I'm going to do what I'm going to do, and that's the end of it. So this, on the other hand, is just saying that, well, the decision you make is your decision, but the man also has a choice to make as well.
I'm saying this, yeah? We say amongst us here, I think we all agreed on it, that men and women are equal, but they're not the same, right?
Yes.
Is that fair for it to say? Is that everybody agrees with that, yeah?
Yes.
Okay. So that idea suggests that there are some things that are in favor of a woman and some things that are in favor of a man that are kind of beyond our our respective control kind of thing, yeah? I would say that I would apply that logic in this situation and say we're equal, but we're not the same. So in this one, men have to take the L.
Do you know what my problem is with both the situations? And it's always going to be my problem. And I think I'm probably one of those people that all these protesters would burn if they saw me on the street or whatever, because I'm pro-life. If that's the term in it, pro-life.
Yes.
When you're against abortion, mm-hmm. right? Because it's like everybody's complaining about the rights of the woman. Everybody's complaining about the rights of the man. No one cares about the rights of the child.
Yeah,
like
yeah.
The rights of the child doesn't exist. You're a fetus, no rights. No rights, no liberties, no nothing. So your rights don't exist. We don't care about you.
Yeah,
care about
in the eyes of the law, you're not a person until X amount of weeks.
Yeah, but when is the X amount of weeks? For me, it's like this, yeah? We said the same thing a minute ago, simple. Right? You both decided you were going to have sex. You both know that if sex happens, it's possible that somebody can get pregnant. It's highly likely if you do it certain ways. It's less likely if you do it others. But there is a likelihood that somebody could get pregnant. Yes, we all agree on that.
Bottom line,
so
yeah.
So if it happens, you take the responsibility of that pregnancy, innit?
Yes.
Right? So I'm excluding rape and all of that stuff in there because people like to throw that in there. And I got my views on that, but I'm not even going to get into that today. But let's just say two general people that went out of their way to have sex with each other, have sex. A child comes from that sex. Take the responsibility and have the child in it. Let that child have that right to live. People always shouting and screaming about the rights of the woman and the man, the woman and the man, the woman and the man, but nobody has the rights. Even the situation that we're talking about now, you're saying, even if the woman and the man says, you know what, I'll come to this agreement, yes, you can waive off the rights and you can go, you don't even care about the right of the child to have a father. That right is now gone from the child for having a father. It's just madness as far as I'm concerned.
Children should just shut up and do as they're taught.
Nah, so I think it's bad. I think we put that in the brain that the rights of the child in this situation mean nothing.
Okay, so Wahala, you're pro-life. Is anyone else in this room pro-life as well? Does anyone share the views of Wahala? Or do you think basically the woman has a choice to... The woman has the decision to make?
I don't think that the woman don't have the decision to make. It's her decision to make. I just think that if you choose to abort a child is wrong. That's my thing. So all of this, you should have a decision.
Okay.
I just think that if you're making a decision...
If you could write in law that you could just ban abortion, would you?
Interesting.
See, that's the thing.
Yeah,
I don't know. I would probably... If I could do it where everybody would be comfortable doing it, I would do it.
But clearly they wouldn't.
There is no way that everybody would be comfortable.
If I could get away with it, I'll probably classify it yes, because I think it's murder.
Then,
so if I think the same thing is murder as everything else, then yes, I'll classify it as murder. Then yes, I'll probably ban it. If I could stop everybody from doing it, I would stop people from doing it.
Well, then that goes to what I was saying before. So does anybody else have similar kind of views?
Do you not have a circumstance applied to that?
No. But,
so even if a woman is the unfortunate victim of rape,
I just said I don't want to talk about that already. I really did just say that.
You did, but
in bringing up that,
but
that
again,
question.
All right, so let's go back to the same thing with the rape thing, yeah, right, and the child, again, right. I understand the problem with that the woman has gone through. I understand that completely, but the thing in my head still doesn't come out of the fact that that child that is being born hasn't done anything wrong, and it should still have rights. So there is no difference in that. The child should still have rights to live. The same way every other child has a right to live. In fact, the same way that you've been traumatized by the situation that's happened to you, that they always say that everything that you do while a woman is pregnant happens to the child as well, no? So that child has also been traumatized, yes? I'm agreed? Are we agreeing on that? So you're going to punish the child enough. People are going to say, you shouldn't say this, but it is. The child's going to be, itself is going to be punished by not being able to live because of what somebody else that it should be punished has done. So that's what I think about that. What I do want to stress is that I understand why a woman would want to get rid of their child if they was raped and a pregnancy occurred from a rape. I can completely understand it. And if somebody said it happened to them and that's what they did, I would judge them. I could not judge everybody for everything. So I wouldn't judge them as harshly as I would judge any other woman that just decided that they was going to have sex one day and got pregnant and then wanted to get rid of it. I won't judge them the same way. I'm completely honest about that. But I'd still think that the child should have a right to live. That's my personal opinion.
Sorry, Black Park here. What if both parties did not want to have the child? So it was an accidental pregnancy. It was unplanned, somehow condom bust, whatever, they became pregnant. Both parties did not want the baby. Is it still the right of the child to be born?
Yes. Yes, it's you are responsible for your actions. This is what I hate about
that's
the
what
world.
I'm saying. If the action was an accidental,
no, it's
action.
Not. It's not accidental action. This is a
accidental sex.
No, yeah, no, it's the pregnancy is accidental. You did not plan on.
But
it
you
happening.
Know that a sex. But this is my issue.
Probably
this is
60% of children born out like accident.
Apparently, we might be talking about this later, so I'll bring this up later. About school, I think in school every child should be taught a lesson called consequences, and they should sit down with a lesson with children. And actually have a class about consequences and your actions and what it does. Because people seem to, in this world now, decide that their actions have no consequences. You know that if you have sex, it could be, as I've said already in this podcast, there could be a likelihood that you're going to have a child. You might not have decided that you want that to happen. And yes, condoms are 99.9% something that can, you know, that you're
effective.
But there's that still that 0.1%. Yeah. So if that 0.1% happens to be you, well, that happens to be you, innit? Right, but you should be responsible for the fact that you did that, and the consequence of your actions should be that you have that child because you decided to go into that situation where you wanted to enter and she wanted to allow entering. That's my personal opinion.
Stavros doesn't necessarily agree with abortion as well. I don't think I'm as hard bodied on it as Wahala, but it's the same premise. I don't like the idea of taking a life. If I had the power to eliminate it, though, I wouldn't. So as much as I disagree with the idea of it, I wouldn't strip the woman the opportunity to do it. I don't know. Maybe that's a double standard.
It doesn't make sense to me. Would you strip somebody? Okay, so you think abortion is murder? Because you did say killing a child, no?
Okay.
Do you think it's murder?
I don't know. I never put it in those words, but if we're going to be pedantic about it, I guess so.
So would you say that if you had...
It's different. So you can give me another example, but then another example is another example.
No, I'm saying that... Okay, but I'm saying murder is murder, isn't it? So murder, if you had the chance to ban murder, would you ban murder?
What type of murder?
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, but... I'm saying it's different. Sorry.
It is different. I mean, abortion in the eyes of the law is not murder, no matter how you want to put it.
Yeah, but
we know that it is.
No, but he's killing. Asking us to say that. He's giving you the option to now say that is the law now. So that's what I'm asking you. If you got the option to say this is law, bang, this is what's meant to happen from now on, no more abortions. Would you make that option? Depending on whether or not you have that stance as being pro-life. Everybody's going to answer this question today, by the way. Nobody throwing me under the bus and let me answer everything. Everybody's going to answer this today.
I mean, this is Mr. Wolf. I think that there's so many different variables. And as much as that you say that you can understand, I'd probably say that you probably can't because you've never been in that situation. So
which situation are you referring
the
to?
The situation of rape.
Okay, yeah.
It's good that you're trying to empathize and you're trying to get into the minds, but unless you've actually been there and felt that feeling of being violated in that way, the emotion and the pain and the hurt and all those kind of things that are going on, and that's going to stick with you for the duration of your life, to then chastise or, you know, to cast a negative judgment on a person for deciding to abort that child, I think it's a bit harsh.
I didn't say I was chastising. If you actually heard what I said, let's rewind. I said I would still say that their child should have a right to live.
You said judge,
and I said, yeah, but how did I say judge? I said the judgment I would give
you wouldn't be as harsh,
would not be that harsh and at the same level as everyone else, and I could completely understand it.
But
let me finish. But I still think that you shouldn't get rid of the child. That's my personal opinion. Right. I'm not judging you. You've been raped, and you know. I don't care that you've been raped, but I didn't say that. I want you to be very clear about that.
Mr. Wolf is kind of, for me, I can't make a decision there to say that you can or you cannot abort a child in the situation of having a rape. It's, you know, it's too difficult for me to put myself into those shoes.
Okay, if we take out the rape situation,
which is what I did in the first place,
would you ban abortion or not? In fact, are you pro-life, first of all?
I am, but I wouldn't ban it.
Okay.
You know.
But then you can't be pro-life then. Because that's what I was saying at the beginning. And you told me that you have to ban it to be pro-life or whatever.
Okay, so I know what you're saying about the teaching kids about circumstances. Sorry, about...
consequences.
Consequences, sorry. And, you know, I'm a grown man, but I know that a lot of my friends, not including me, broke their virginity at a very young age. Do you understand? And we spoke on previous podcasts about children getting into situations and not really knowing what they're doing and not knowing the consequences. Now, you can teach people algebra, but they'll forget algebra maybe in a couple of years if they don't continue to learn it. Do you understand? And if a child has had sex at the age of 13 and the girl has become pregnant, you know, it is the decision of her family, the decision of her, if they want to keep the child or not. If you ban the idea of having abortions, it changes a lot of lives, man. You know, it's for me, it's too difficult just to stamp it out altogether. There's too many variables for me.
Web Slinger or Simple Simon, one of you jump in. Would you ban it? Are you pro-life or pro-choice?
You're real difficult, Simple Simon. See, after listening to Mr. Wolf there now, there's things I agree with on both of their sides. And I was even thinking that, technically speaking, a child is intellectual property as well. It's your own intellectual property. And if you don't have autonomy over your own intellectual property, then is it really your intellectual property? So, again...
The child is property of the state these days.
But the child becomes property of the state at the point of registration.
Yeah.
So before that, it's your intellectual property, or at least 50% of it.
But then also, sorry, Webb's here, in the eyes of certain laws, it's non-existent.
What's non-existent?
The child.
Can you two answer the question, please?
I've answered the question as far as I'm concerned. I don't know. I really don't know. I don't know. I can't call it.
No, you know what? There was this woman that just walked past and she had a skirt and you were skirting around it, man. Come on, answer that damn question.
No, seriously. I can't call it.
People like to dodge this question.
No, because...
I knew they would dash me under the bus.
No, it's not that. The problem is, yeah...
The thing is,
the problem is, you put an absolute in there saying, would you just ban rape absolute across the board? And I didn't abortions across the board. And I didn't even...
I didn't say across the board, actually.
You did.
When I asked Mr. Wolf, I took out the rape situation and you said that's why you wanted to take it out. So I said...
But then, taking that out, okay, cool.
So one has to answer the full one.
Okay. But then even if you take the rape scenario out of the situation, I didn't even think of... The scenario that Mr. Wolf just gave, where you're talking about like a teenage child or a young girl or whatever, I didn't even think about that.
Can I just touch on something quickly? This is my problem with society as a whole, because we've decided to make all of these situations on these constructs of how we're supposed to live. That's why we got this problem in the first place, because people believe that having a child so young, or having a child at a certain age, or doing this or whatever, is meant to conflict of what your life is meant to be. As far as I'm concerned, as a human being, our life is to make more life. That is the purpose of a human being. All of this added extra stuff that we do is added extras. What we're here to do now is to have more human beings. That's the whole purpose of a human being, as far as I'm concerned, to continue the human race.
More life.
So why are we now trying to find ways of... The whole problem is that we've now decided to find ways of making that least important than anything else. Now we've put all of these extra things that we're doing. So you're talking about a 14-year-old and a 15-year-old having a child, and that being that, you know, such a bad thing that they might have to decide to feel about getting rid of the child, when actually they're doing their purpose in life.
Or even a 13-year-old girl, 14-year-old girl being raped. Okay, by her father.
No, we removed the rape.
Doesn't have to always go to... This is what I'm saying. Every time we're having a discussion, it has to go to the extreme. The first thing people always go about is rape.
You must... In my opinion, this is Mr. Wolf speaking, you cannot eliminate that factor when you're talking about abortion.
Yes, you can. Do you think that the majority of abortions that happen in just saying the UK is due to rape?
I don't know the statistics, but what I do know is that is a factor. 100%.
I'm not disputing that it's not, but that's the first thing that everybody always goes for. And there's plenty of abortion that happens. It's got nothing to do with rape.
Web Slinger, what is your answer? Are you pro-life, pro-choice, and would you ban abortion if you could?
First off, I would like to say there are so many variables in this. I am pro-life. However, taking out the subject that we keep skirting around that we want to take out. If a child is born into a family that, one, there may be mental health issues within the family, two, there may be poverty issues, there could be so many issues that will cause this child to have a very, very detrimental life, a bad life, and not a good life.
Listen, Ghanaians can do well, you know.
Oh, my they can, God. They can.
But should they be allowed to?
No, come no. on.
In situations like
levels
this...
Levels of xenophobia.
In situations like this, is it the right thing to do to allow a child to be born into this sort of lifestyle? Because it will face drama, trouble, trauma, upset.
You assume.
I assume, but in most cases, that is the case. And then if
you,
that...
You don't know.
You can never know. That child could change those people's lives completely.
That child could change those people's lives completely. And it's a 50-50 thing. You cannot say yes and you can't say no. But looking at those variables, it causes such a big question mark.
Okay.
Even on that respect, because I know of an autistic child that had a baby, and as an autistic child doesn't understand the construct of being a parent.
And child or child having a baby. Oh, that's what
child
he said.
Had a child.
Yeah, how old is she?
15.
Okay.
Child and not understanding child. The constructs of being a parent. But her parents were like, no, it'll be fine. She'll learn. She's not going to learn.
Why?
Because of her autism.
Yeah, autism doesn't mean you don't learn.
There's some very,
you have
very
to learn
smart.
How to be a parent.
There's some very, very smart autistic
There's very people. Smart autistic people, but they don't know how to be parents.
What do you mean they don't
Nobody know knows how to be a parent.
Exactly. But in the construct of being an autistic child, your smartness or your level of intelligence will go to a certain level.
Not necessarily.
Yes, necessarily.
No, the
have you studied autism?
Yeah, the spectrum of autism is so broad.
Yes.
Yeah, that you can go from autistic people who don't understand social interaction all the way down to hyper-focused autistic people who can actually...
Known as geniuses even.
Yeah,
so on the, exactly. on the side of not understanding social interaction, how to interact with your child
That's
will be
very,
an issue.
Very important.
Exactly.
Yeah, but
so
it's
things like
it's broad though.
It is broad. I'm not saying it's not broad, but this is why this question has so many different variables, because there are so many things that can come
so
into
many
play.
Variables. But then, as I said, for me, all of this stuff that people are putting in, I get it. And I agree with a lot of the things that everybody's saying. As I said, I get the trauma that comes in certain situations. I get it. I understand. What I'm saying is that in this situation, and as I said, that's why even when you want to put the rape situation and all of that into it, I don't understand being raped, as Mr. Wolf said. I get that as well. I get what you're saying with that. And I'm never going to be one to tell you, unless obviously it happens to me, which I pray that it never does. That I'm going to tell you that I understand, so I don't understand. But what I would know is that obviously there is going to be the stress on that parent, on the mother. And even if, and it's not even just the mother, everybody around that child is going to have that distress. I get it. But what I'm saying is, in the end, my question is, what happens to the right of that child to live? That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah, Webslinger. So
not
answer.
About all of the rest.
So answer, Webs.
He answered.
Because we need, what did he say?
He said he's pro-life. That's the first thing he said.
Yes.
A Gaza with a fire, but
huh? So you would ban abortion. Wonderful. Okay. So let's move on to the next one.
You just took my rights away.
Bastard.
All right. We're running out of time. We got time for... All right, let's do a couple of quick ones. Obama is coming out of office.
Man.
He's coming out of office. What are your guys' views on Obama the last 8 years? You know, his family and whatnot.
Obama, the best thing to happen since sliced bread.
Are you being real?
Who is that saying?
I'm being real. Webb's here.
What did he do that is so good? That's
Obamacare,
and then what?
That's enough for me.
All right, so you don't care about the fact
suave,
that he allows...
sophisticated.
Do you know about
Obamacare? I know about Obamacare. I'm looking at him as a man in general. First man, first black man in a White House built by slaves. House built by slaves.
Mixed
man
race.
Man is living in it. Mixed race, whatever. He's black. Okay? Take the Ghanaian out of him, he's black. Simple.
He's not Ghanaian.
I know he's not Ghanaian. Thank God for that.
Oh, why are we just getting these lot today? I have love for the Ghanaians. Man, I have love for you all, bro. Let's just say all that.
You're fucked up. All of y'all just fucked up. For our Ghanaian listeners, we've got this thing where we just kind of have a go at you guys a little bit. you know, but it's all love, really.
Yeah, if, listen, if, it started in season one. In fact, it started before season one. It started early on in our lives. And it
started when they were created.
No, don't listen. If you're Ghanaian and you're listening to this and you're wondering what's going on, I'm the half Jamaican in the room, and I get it as well. So
that's it.
It's
what, yeah. You get the hatred.
I get you. Not drop some bombs. The hatred on me
towards Ghanaians, not the hatred towards.
Look at this. I'm not involved.
So both sides of you hate Ghanaians.
Right? All right, let's get back to Obama. Just because. Saying. I don't want them to feel like we do have a hatred for them, because we don't. So let's go back to our world.
Stavros is married to a Ghanaian, by the way.
Oh yeah, which makes it so ironic. But anyway, let's go back to what you're saying about Obama, because for me, I think a lot of people like Obama the person, and I get why you like Obama the person. He comes, you know, on the mic. He spits 2-2 bars.
He even drops the mic.
Yeah, drops the mic. He's funny. He's charismatic. You know, he dances with his wife. His wife seems happy. His children seem happy. He doesn't have any
scheme. He dances with his wife.
Yeah. Tick. Every man does that, though.
Reasons to love a man. He dances with his wife. Tick. Yeah.
But you know.
All the other people. He does what?
Yeah, but you know what I mean. You know what I mean. But, you know, he's charismatic. He knows how to speak well. He speaks so eloquently. He speaks so well.
He speaks so well. He speaks but so well.
As a president and what foreign. He's done, to be honest, I don't see he's made any major differences, especially as a black person, as you said. He hasn't done much for his people.
Compared to other presidents.
Yeah, compared to other presidents, he hasn't done much for his people.
He does for his people, as in the people that he governs, or his people as in black people?
As I said, blacks. Because as far as I'm concerned, there's been a lot of things that's been going on with black people during his, especially at the end of his reign, where he could have probably been a bit more forceful, and he decided to take a more of a backseat against.
I think he was in a catch 22. He thought, if I'm a bit too
pro,
if I force things forward in terms of defending, representing, and uplifting black people, then I'll be accused of being the black man that's just looking out for his own people.
And so what? Because that's what every white president's been doing since the beginning of time.
But the thing is, he's the first black.
And will be the black last.
In quotation marks, president.
He's not actually. I forget the name of the first black president, but it's not him.
Well, okay. Until you can give me the name, I'm going to stick with the first
one. Who are you thinking?
There was somebody that said was a black president, but I don't
know. I don't know if he was actually president, though.
I think he was. Perhaps.
You think he was, perhaps. I don't know his name. I'll find out. Nigerian logic. Thank you very much. So,
his name was Tunde.
As far as he's concerned, I feel it's that I've just got my foot in the door, or I'm bringing these people along with me, and I'm progressing things slowly. If I try and push it too much, it's like a rubber band, and it's going to snap back, and then I'm going to set us as a people back. So let me get my foot in the door, spread things open, and the next person will come through and do what needs to be done.
Nah, sorry, I can't say that.
Sorry, Simple Simon here. What the hell did you just say?
I'm saying that if let's take it as a company, and I become a manager of the company, and then all of a sudden I'm promoting the black people. I'm giving the black people, you know, extra rights, even if I'm just making up for things that were done poorly in the past.
Mm-hmm.
It's gonna be seen, if they're the minority of the company, if they're 10%, it's gonna be seen by maybe the 65% majority that this person is showing favoritism. Now, when it's time to vote in a new leader in 4 years' time, this majority are going to say, well, we're not doing another black dude, because all he does since he's been here is promote the blacks, help out the blacks, give the blacks extra, and do this and that. And we want somebody that's fair. And that's not fair. That's how they're going to see it, because what he did was, as much as he might have been making up for a historical wrong, today he's just doing stuff for his people, and so we're gonna vote somebody else in. So he might, so the head of the company might say, I'm gonna do very small incremental changes that are significant. They're significant, but they're not like mind blowing.
All right.
And then the next, so when I leave, they're not gonna say we're not gonna hire another black person. They might still hire another black person.
All right, let me put it to you like this, yeah. I kind of get what you're saying, yes. But I'm gonna go as far as to say to you, this is a once in a lifetime opportunity, yeah? So let's say he went in his first term and he didn't do anything in his first term that would stop him from getting voted in for his second term. You see that second term where he's got them 4 years? Black should have been at the front of his agenda.
I'm going in.
But this is why I said it's not about him. It's about what.
No, because you said something about you said about the future and about him opening doors and letting somebody listen. I can tell you for now, yeah, that there isn't going to be any next black president in a long time. So even if he did set up all the pins ready to drop and all you have to do is blow a little breeze on them, the next person's not going to blow breeze in that direction.
He said that, but his wife might be able to get through, you know.
His wife might be able to get through, yeah? Mm. But
after Trump's administration, they might let anybody through again.
I'm saying he should have taken the last four. I was saying it would have been nice. I'm not going to tell you what he should have done. It would have been nice if he took the last 4 years and Mugabe the situation.
He should have at least backed. No, seriously, he should have at least.
Mugabe's a verb now, yeah.
No, he should have at least backed it for the guys that was getting shot all over the place by the.
No. Let me put it to you this way. Yeah.
By doing what? Overruling the law, the judges.
No, it's not necessarily the law, the judges. But he needs to condemn the police. Like he was going out of his way to try and condemn the police. I get why, because they're the police, and if he starts condemning them, the rest of the world. But yes, he should condemn them and say,
it's the same thing that Trump's now doing with his people, CIA, and their man's not going to back it for him.
All right, let me not make it black and white. It's still black and white, but let me not make it black and white. Yeah, if Obama, Sir Barack Hussein, if he wanted to win points, yeah, in the demographic that we're talking about, all he had to do was fix Flint, Michigan. That Flint, Michigan water crisis should not still be going on right now if Obama is for the people.
He's sending all this money to Israel 100%. For them to go kill off the Muslims exactly. All over the place.
So even if you don't want to get into it and say, 100%. Oh yeah, the police shootings and all the rest of it, 100%. He should have fixed Flint, Michigan. Because to me, Flint, Michigan and Hurricane Katrina, now don't get me wrong, I know Hurricane Katrina is not man-made and it's nothing to do with man. And you know, that's the law of nature. But they responded badly to that. This Flint, Michigan thing wasn't even as bad as Hurricane Katrina, and he didn't respond at all. They've still not got the water in Flint, Michigan.
Mr. Wolf, Cole signs Simple Simon 100%. Now, I'm one who has got a lot of good things to say about Obama. I think that him being there, maybe not for our generation, but for the generations, the younger generation, it's a very big deal. When my son sees Barack Obama, when the young kids see a black man in that position of power, I tell them, look at that, you can achieve anything. Now, in terms of people wanting him to do more for his people, if he'd done as much as he could, personally, I think they would have assassinated him. And I'm not even messing around it. I think that they would have killed the guy, they would have shot him off. If you're looking at certain conspiracies and how a lot of people will say he is a puppet in a situation and you've got the puppeteers telling him what to do. If you are really of a sound mind, you would kind of believe these kind of things. He's been put in a position to do a job just like Trump has. Yeah?
Yeah.
So my thing is that he's been put in a position to do a particular job. If he deviates from the job that he's been given, for me, they would take him out. No long thing. But in terms of him as a black man in that situation, in that position of power, and when you look at him as a black man and his family, the love for his family, his black woman, his children, all of that put into one, for me, it's a big deal.
That's important for black people.
It's a very big deal. The black family and the unity. For American black people. For me, for everybody.
Because I say American black people because the way that people perceive America, you know, let me go.
I think the way how they perceive the black family generally.
In general. Let me touch on the story that I had with regards to that. I was on Facebook one time discussing on a page. It was one of my friend's page. The person's Muslim and they're Asian. Asian Muslim, yeah? So they were talking about black. I don't know what it was about anyway, but it ended up being about black families. And somebody came on the status and actually said another, it was his uncle, so it was another Asian Muslim, and actually said to, I don't even know why I'm saying Muslim, but this is adding that in there. Actually said that black families don't know anything about having parents, like mum and dad, they don't even understand it or acknowledge it.
That's the perception from
outside.
That's
what they said. And I had to come and say, what you think that? He goes, yeah, basically he's trying to say that black people have been so messed up, they don't even understand how to be mum and dads. They don't even understand how to be a family unit.
So he's talking about the American context.
He's talking about the West, isn't he? I had to say to him, so in my head, I was going to start going in, and then I said, you know what? I can't actually even talk to this human being, because if I go in, I'm going to go in hard. Because I'm saying, so what about all of the whole of Africa where there's a parent, a mum, there's a dad, and there's a child, a unit, all over the whole of Africa. That unit is there. In fact, it's probably there more than it is the other way around where there's only one parent. He just didn't acknowledge that, and just was talking about England.
1.1 billion people, yeah. He just forgot them.
Forgot them, because all he knows is that black people don't have mum. I mean, black dads don't stay with their children. They run off and leave the mum on their own. That's what he thought.
Because it's the Western world. People that are of different cultures, they mostly look at black America as the benchmark of how black people are. You know, they don't look at black Africa. They don't look at South American blacks. They don't look at Asian blacks or other people in different parts of the world. They look at what black America is doing, and so that means every black is like that.
But the reason why I was even saying the fact that the guy was a Muslim is because the one thing I'll say about Muslims is that there's a lot of African Muslims. So a lot of Muslims that are Asian in society, probably within London and all this area, probably know quite a few black people. And he must have, you know, he must have seen black families that are completely together. So for him to say that, for me, like, it's more likely for me, I don't know, I know that black Muslims mix quite a bit with Muslim Asians, so they must see quite a bit of it, if you know what I mean.
So blacks are a victim of stereotype, period, you know, and that is just unfortunate. So a lot of people that are not part of our culture, they will say that blacks are violent, black women do this, or black men are like this. And part of that stereotype is the black family is non-existent. And this is why, that for these people that look at America as the benchmark, in inverted commas, for black people, when they see a black family like that in the most powerful position, apparently, in the world, for me, it's a big deal. A very, very big deal. And for that alone, for what Barack Obama has maybe done to people that are closest to me, maybe my children, my younger cousins, and people that I know that look at that and think, "Wow, that's a big deal." I would commend him and salute him for that.
All right, then. Last topic is going to be about Michael Jackson. Now, there was a program that was going to be, well, it's still going to be shown on Sky Arts.
No, it's not.
No, if you let me finish, you'll see what I'm talking about. You bastard.
How can we see what you're talking about? We can hear it. We can't see it.
Words so vivid you can see what I'm saying.
Word.
So, there's a show on Sky Arts that will be shown called Urban Myths. It's a comedy show, and they have different episodes. The episode in question, which has Michael Jackson being played by, what's the
Joseph Fiennes.
Yes, Joseph Fiennes, a white man, will not be shown, but the rest of them will be. It was taken out of the list. Sky Arts have apologized the day that we're recording.
So there.
And they said we're not going to show it because there was a big uproar for a white man playing Michael Jackson. And I think the biggest one was obviously his daughter, who said, once she saw the trailer for the program, said it disgusted her, made her feel sick or something like that. And she thinks it's disrespectful and disgraceful to her father, who's clearly not her father because she's
Joseph Fiennes looks white. More like her dad than the Michael Jackson that she's saying is the dad. I'm just being real here.
But what are your views on them using a white? Because me personally,
seen who?
Paris Jackson.
Oh, Paris. You're saying that the guy who's playing Michael Jackson looks more like him than his apparent daughter.
No, the guy that's playing Michael Jackson, Joseph Fiennes, looks more like he could be Paris Jackson's father.
Oh, that's okay. I get that.
What are your guys' views on all this stuff, man?
I think it's ridiculous. For one, the man himself said he don't want people playing him. He said that, "I don't want a white person playing me when you do my films. Don't do it." And the first thing they go and do is do it. I think they were trying
who
to.
Who said that?
Michael Jackson said it. He said it. I think he's even on tape saying it. They asked him, and he goes, "Of course I don't want a white man to play me. I'm a black man. I'm a proud black man." Vexed. Yeah, he was vexed. Yeah. You know, Michael gets vexed sometimes, isn't
he? I need to watch that video.
What a blood clot. He got vexed. He was sitting there vexed.
He was about to shame.
I've been quiet
people
for too long.
He looked like he was gonna throw a stew at the woman's eyes if you asked him that question again. But
I can't know. Are you sure that was a specific question? I can remember him saying that he's black and he's proud to be black. I think the question was like, do you want to be white or do you see yourself as white or something like that?
Maybe
you
might.
I don't necessarily think it's about.
But he blatantly
Of course, I'm black. Of course, I'm black.
And how you and I'm proud to be black. Portrayed.
Maybe.
Well, yeah. I love Michael Jackson. You know his music. Well, there's not much that people need to say with reference to him and his legacy that he's left. With him saying, "I'm proud to be black," and X, Y, and Z.
And this was in his white stage, yes.
It, for me, that just rubs me up the wrong way. The guy straightened out his nose, thinned out his lips, straightened his hair, and do we need to say much about his skin? And then he apparently brings someone into this world who clearly is not his, and the child is white. So for someone like that to then say, "I am pro-black."
Is Vida Lago.
Yeah, that's what he said. I'm not buying that, mate. It's a lot.
That's
of nonsense.
Severe vitiligo. I don't think he actually did have. See, this is my theory. I think he did have vitiligo.
I think he did,
and
but
I think he just decided to just take off all of it to just match his skin.
Yes,
which is not the. I'm not saying it's a good thing, but I think he did that.
He straightened his nose.
That is where he went.
Thinned his lips.
He wanted to look like Elizabeth Taylor. They
straightened his eyes. You know,
straightened his eyes.
Straightened his hair.
Man says straighten his eyes.
Hey, you shut up your mouth and straighten your eyes. Don't look at me.
I've heard that. But now, I mean, Michael Jackson, his legacy will forever live on. And when I see people put pictures of Michael on their profile pictures, when it's his birthday or the day of his death or whatever, it's always the old, the younger looking Michael Jackson, the older pictures of him. You know, nobody can really relate to the Michael Jackson.
Don't say nobody.
I'm sure that there's many people that could relate, but I'm not sure.
I think most people relate to him like that.
I don't think some people.
I can't relate to the white Michael Jackson.
I don't think there's many.
I can relate to the music and his legacy, but the way how he looked, I can't relate to.
Who was better looking in the face, Michael Jackson or Caitlyn Jenner?
Look at that boy.
I'm not looking at Caitlyn Jenner in any way, shape, or form, or Michael Jackson. So you answer your own damn question.
I didn't mean like that. Come on.
So what do you mean? I don't get what you mean.
Let's go back to Michael Jackson.
I think with regards to what you were saying again, with regards to that thing, I do think that most people probably actually remember Michael White now. If I'm honest, in black. I remember my mum always used to say, Michael, when he was black, he was a fine boy. He was very fine. Like, she was upset about what he'd done. Mm. Like, a lot of black people were probably upset about what they think he'd done or what's happened and how his skin changed or whatever. But that's here nor there. I still don't think they should be making a white man plain. I think this is one time where black man should go whiteface. White people with that blackface for bare years. It's one time where a black man should go whiteface and be done with it. If they really need to have Michael Jackson to look that shade and that colour, they should have got Wesley Snipes and just put tutu powder on his face. Yes, did get the blackest that you can find and put tutu powder on his face and let him do it.
With his broad nose and big lips.
Yes.
So here's the thing now. When I first heard about this, because I've heard about
Wesley Snipes!
I've heard about this from...
You karate and everything.
I've heard about this from quite a while ago and I was like, just shocked, like, you're getting a white person to play Michael Jackson. It doesn't make no sense. And then I didn't know the concept of it. I thought it was an actual documentary about his life or, you know, a biopic or whatever. And then once I've seen the trailer now, it's a full-on
comedy.
Yeah, it's a full-on nonsense comedy, which, to be honest, alleviated my...
concerns.
Yeah, concerns a tad. Because then it's like, if you're just taking a mic of... all the, because it's a bunch of celebrities they have there, and they're taking the mic out of all the celebrities. So if you're taking the mic out of all the celebrities, then fair enough. This is one way they're taking the mic out of Michael Jackson.
No, but in real talk though, yeah, I'm gonna be a bit of an advocate here. Was Michael like white in the face for longer than he was black?
I was thinking exactly the same thing.
He died when in his 40s, didn't he? Or was he 50 or something?
He was in his 50s, I think.
He was in his 50s.
Well, let me find out, because I don't have any issues.
He started looking a bit...
56.
He started looking a bit tony around.
Because bad is the last time I remember him being...
A shade of it was
actually bad.
What's the album that came after bad?
Remember the time? Dangerous.
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 No, Dangerous, he was in full formation there.
No, not full.
No, I don't think it was full.
He was
Dangerous, he still had a bit of shade.
Then. He was a lighter skinned of mixed race.
Dangerous, he still had a bit of shade.
Yeah, just he did.
He did.
He did. Yeah.
He was quarter cast.
Was Dangerous the one? Which one we had to remember the time? Because that's when he was full.
Dangerous.
Yeah, no, he was full Elvis Presley. He
weren't, man. No chance. He was full Elvis during the time that he'd done the song with Elvis Presley's daughter.
Priscilla.
Then
he did a team with Priscilla as well. Yeah, he moved to Priscilla.
They were
together,
they
man.
Were married.
Oh, yeah. That man moved to some vagina, you know?
Of course he did. Because I remember that, no, the video, yeah, the remember video, he
that's
was glowing.
Money, right?
He was glowing.
He was glowing. No, he was glowing like an actual angel on the screen. Like the saturation of his skin color against the camera wouldn't allow him to look like a normal human being. He looked like he had a halo just fuzzing around him.
When did he burn, what was it when he burnt himself? Was Pepsi. It the Pepsi advert? Was that, when was that?
That was in the 80s.
That and was he was still on black. Stage.
Yeah, he was still black. Yeah.
He was still black then.
But I thought that was one 82. Of the reasons why something happened where he had
that
surgery.
Was Thriller. That
that's
was
when he
thriller
had plastic
album.
Surgery, didn't
his
he?
Thriller album.
He something burned and then he had to. That's what they say anyway. Thriller. I was watching a documentary about all of this.
That's
stuff.
What
they
you
say
get for having
a stage light fell or the spark from the stage light burnt his hair. It engulfed. It was. He had flammable lotion in him hair.
Okay, so we're saying that when did Dangerous come out then? What year?
Dangerous. I'll find out. But he was 50 when he died.
50 when he died. So let's say that he
damn, that's young, you know.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying. He wasn't that old. So if he was 50 when he died, and we're saying Dangerous them times there,
he'd been black longer than
he had been black longer than he had been the other shade of whatever we're gonna
he
call.
He had been black.
Yeah,
he's more beige, wasn't he? Wasn't necessarily
beige.
Around 91ish.
Beige.
Oh, so then what? Dangerous, because Dangerous wasn't where it started.
He would have been a little bit before Dangerous.
So he didn't start before Dangerous.
He started before Dangerous.
He didn't. He wasn't bringing that album a year now. Come on,
exactly. It was before Dangerous. So if you say 91 to 2016,
so
my math ain't good.
No, if you look at Thriller, all right, say from Thriller first. Thriller was 16. With the whole
2016, yeah, 15 years.
Contouring the whole lip surgery and nose surgery.
All right, so he was black.
Oh, sorry,
in 1988, 20. His skin transformation began.
So he's from 88.
Come on, man. So by the between 88 and 90.
What album was 88?
I don't know about. I'm not going by albums.
He was by albums, man.
We've been waiting 88, boy.
Going by albums.
So yeah, so basically he was probably white for as long as he's black, if not longer.
You know,
beige.
Because what's your views on the actual program? Do you feel that now you know that it's a full on slapstick comedy? Do you still feel that it shouldn't have happened, or do you feel that it's cool?
I don't. Wahala doesn't think it should have happened. I think it's still a disrespect. I think that that's the biggest black icon we've got. Even though he turned white, he was still the biggest black icon we have. He should be kept as a black icon, and we should have done whiteface.
Webs?
In the elements of comedy goes to any broad spectrum, but for the fact that it's Michael, don't fuck with Michael, man.
So the acting side of you is not taking over and saying, look, we need to be able to express
nah,
ourselves.
Nah, man, I'll renounce my acting
we need
side
to be
in
fabulous.
That respect. I'm sorry, no. It's Michael. Don't fuck with Michael, brother. Okay, he's serious. Man will come to your house. All right, you,
calm down.
It's MJ, bro.
Yeah, MJ went to many young people's houses. All right.
Wow.
Mr. Wolf.
It's a tough one. I think the comedy aspect, once for me, alleviates a lot of the issues that I would have had because I didn't know too much about it anyway. You know, freedom of speech and freedom to do what you want. You know, I love Michael, but in reality, I don't really give a shit.
Fair enough.
Simple, Simon.
I'm going to say that they shouldn't have done it simply for the fact that the man said in no uncertain terms that he didn't want a white person to pay him.
Exactly.
So respect that, innit? Respect that. You got that on video, respect it. Man said he doesn't want it. You don't wait till he dies and then go and do that. So I would say no, they shouldn't have done it.
That's
so I'm happy that they pulled it.
That's actually like spitting on his grave, bro.
Red. Hot. Revival. I love to preach tonight.
How about you, Stavros, boss?
I'm along the lines of what you were saying earlier on. Before, when I thought it was serious, I thought it was the biggest disrespect. Then when I saw it was a comedy, I kind of shrugged my shoulders and said, oh, well, okay, I'm not really that bothered anymore.
Okay, so if you died,
yeah,
God forbid it happens, but let's say it does happen, you're going to die at some point.
At some point.
And you've died and you're such a legend as
when,
you are.
When my wife hears this episode,
and
yeah,
Danny Dyer plays you.
Yeah, in blackface. In the blackest face they could fight.
And calls himself a legend. That was the
would you be alright with that?
No.
See, I don't get it. It's the same thing. It's just, although they didn't do whiteface, they did whiteface. Or blackface, sorry. They did it in the opposite way.
Not even Danny Dyer, Steve McFadden.
Who's that?
Phil Mitchell. Whee!
And he's cracked himself. He'll play you quite well, man.
Crack himself.
Oi, Cafe. I think it's a bit different. Almost like what Mr. Wolf said. He almost brought it on himself by... If
he almost brought it on himself.
Well, who told him to turn himself white?
Yeah,
he's like wanted to be asexual. No race. No
intersexual. Allow it.
Is that what intersexual is?
I don't know.
No
idea. He wanted to be like, I have no race and I have no color. I'm every man.
I'm every man.
So, but he's a legend.
Of course, he's a legend. The man said, "Do you remember when he?" Fell in love.
Are you that, bro?
Yeah, bro, I can speak the bus. She was young and innocent then.
Like, he said it. I don't really care. They don't care about us.
Can you imagine if man just started? Man should be saying that to their wives all the time, you know? Just randomly going into the house and saying, I bet you remember.
No.
I cleaned that
key. Shake the woman.
Do you remember, girl? On the floor. You and me. Till dawn. Till tree. What about us? Girl. Batman. Michael was banging. a bad The original banging, baby father was Michael. There's two baby fathers, I say originals. Darth Vader and Michael Jackson.
You are the father.
I am your father.
Wait, I didn't
know. I was
the tests have come back. And what was Darth Vader's real name?
Anakin.
And Anakin. You are the father.
And apparently he didn't know.
No.
But then I don't understand how he knew later though.
So you look, that's later. What happens when you
the
bang.
The force made him know.
And that's the consequences.
Are you talking about Michael Jackson then though?
No, Darth Vader didn't
Anakin
know.
Anakin didn't know.
But brother, how did you say Darth Vader? How did he come into
I said they're two baby fathers, isn't it?
Because you know that. Have you not seen Star Wars?
Original baby fathers.
Yeah. And Michael Jackson is saying the kid ain't mine.
What man? This one you just know. Michael Jackson said what he wants. He said, "The kid ain't mine." Yeah. I loved it.
He said, "Billie Jean is not my lover. She's just a girl." Who claims that I am the one, but the kid is not my son.
You know what? Lyrics. One day I listened to that tune, yeah, and I thought, you know what? Michael's deep in that.
He's deep. A bad man. He's a pop-up bad. He did not have it. He didn't ask for paternity or nothing. He said, that ain't mine, fam.
When he put it in song and it went top 10, number one,
that
he knows.
Ain't mine.
And then he came Jaheim, back and told
Jaheim
the girl.
Tried the same thing.
You remember
Jaheim had that song, that yeah, little oh, baby yeah, ain't yeah, mine. Yeah. Nah, he didn't even say it. When Jaheim said it, I didn't believe. When Michael said, that ain't mine. I looked at the woman and said, you better find the baby before I'm gonna child, because Michael said that she ain't his. Michael said that she ain't his, bro. And I tend to believe
him. Look at the woman, you better go find
her. I tend to believe him.
Oh my gosh.
I could have seen the sex tape, but I would still say it was his.
The baby come out white like Paris, he said it's not mine. So there you go.
Oh my days.
You get me?
You see what I'm yeah. You've killed me today.
Ah, phlegm.
Wow.
My God.
Okay. And that has brought the end of Eloquently Saying Nothing, episode number 3.
Damn it.
I hope you all enjoyed what you've heard so far. Let's go around and do the socials and give us the church notes at the end, and then you can go about your business. So, wahala, speak on it.
Yes, another show down. What am I supposed to be doing? Just giving my socials out.
Yep.
I'm at Big Wahala on Twitter, at Big Wahala on Instagram with no photos. Just see a blank page, but I'm there now. Follow me in it. I'll start putting up some content at some point soon. I don't know what, but maybe I'll just put random pigeons or something on there.
Pigeons running from Jollof.
Yeah. I don't know, but we'll see.
Simple Simon FB on Twitter, trying to get a little bit more active on there. You probably won't find me on Facebook unless you're already a friend. I'm like really close quartered like that. I know that don't make sense, but that's just how I are.
But so hit me up on Twitter. I'm on there most of the time. That's what it is.
Mr. Wolf, aka Yemi. You can get me on Instagram on it's Yemi.
Every week.
Oh, Yemi's Insta.
Every week. Man Yemi's doesn't Insta. Know his Insta or his Twitter.
Yemi's Insta and Twitter is it's Yemi online. And John Hansen was the apparent black president, but he wasn't. So there you go. I think it was the first black senator.
From Sunrise, follow your boy, the actor. Sunset, it's DJ Webslinger. And Mr. Obama, aka Barry, supersedes any president in his popularity.
Politics. And in the things that he done. I didn't get a chance to list them, but hey.
Also, Barry has shot more lengths while he's been in control.
Baza.
And I mean like more than Bush, more like... More,
I don't believe that.
More lengths have been shot. Apparently.
I don't believe that.
Apparently.
I don't believe that.
Okay.
Not when Bush was there licking off shots.
He got Ben Harden though. He did get Ben Harden.
We will discuss this offline. First of all, I would just like to apologize to the LGBTQ community because I mistook the Q for queer.
No, it is queer as well.
It's queer. And
apparently it's LGBTQQI.
Two Qs.
Yeah, there's Q. So there's Q for queer. It used to be queer. Then they decided to add questioning as well as
queer. So it was queer before?
It was queer at some point.
So who's correcting me?
And then there's I for intersex. And then there's A for...
Wait, hang on.
Absolutely
you
nonsense.
You just didn't read the article.
No, there's lots.
I didn't read anything. Man.
I posted the article because it pissed me off. Because people were telling me that I was saying I was wrong as well.
Wait, hang on. Did you say intersex?
Intersex, I think it is.
Which one is this?
Intersex?
I don't know.
That is an R. Kelly song for sure.
So what? I don't know what it is.
Are they preparing for Mars or
but
something?
I don't know what it is. But there's so many. It's like it got longer and longer as the day got by to the point where it might as well... It literally should just be the alphabet.
Okay. No, the question would be blood. Are you intersex?
Okay, so... Oh, right. It was brought
inter.
Up in social media that the Q standed for what was it?
Questioning.
Hold on, did I say standard? Yes. It's standard. Yes, it's standard for.
I standed it.
Standard for questioned.
Stood.
I'm saying standard. I'm staying firm in my wrongness. Yeah. It standed for question, and that's what I was apologizing for.
He said it again.
Yes, I will keep saying it. I'm gonna keep saying it. So yeah, so that's why I was apologising. So if you personally have any views that you want to bring forward, you can holler at us at ESN Podcast on Twitter, on Instagram. Wahala's going to start get the Instagram popping, apparently. And none of us have... Any of you ever used Snapchat before?
No.
Well, because we're big, big people. I bet you've used Snapchat. Nope. All right, so
don't even look at it.
We're on Snapchat as well. We're on all these things at ESN, at ESN Podcast. On Facebook, come join our group, our page. Like us and subscribe and then you'll get all the updates. And that's at ESN Podcasts with an S at the end.
Snapchat me.
So you can also send your questions through Facebook. And you can... And you can email us at esnpodcast@gmail.com. So that's how you can get all your information through to us. Ask us questions and we'll discuss it next week, potentially.
esnpodcast@gmail.com?
Yeah.
Okay.
Why you say that?
Because I just wanted to make sure it was at ESN. I didn't know myself, so it's at esnpodcast@gmail.com.
Well, it's just esnpodcast@gmail.com.
ESN Podcast or ESN Podcasts.
T.
No S.
Yeah. The only thing that's got S is the Facebook. So that's that. I'm Stavros Boss, at Stavros Boss everywhere you can find me. And that's the end of the episode. Oh, Ghanaians, sorry. We're not sorry. But no.
This man has to go home to his wife. He doesn't know it yet. That day that she sees him on this podcast, he won't get food that day, boy.
She just suffocate.
Banco.
Suffocate with one watchy boy.
We love you people, really. But
yeah, you people. Jesus.
You're one of them anyway. No.
I'm not one of them. And neither is my child.
Have you read Kente?
Listen. Did he say neither is my child?
Layers, people, layers.
Remember, if you ain't saying nothing, say it well.
Slack for life.
Yeah.
Listen, I'm not one of them people.
Have you read Kente?
Like a star.
Oh.
Yow. 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 Yow.